because, of course, I think it's in about the last 20 years it's become really topical, and it's now hugely researched and so on. And maybe one could lose sight of the fact that it's actually been around roughly 2,500 years that we know of. And during that time, it's obviously played a significant role in the development of thinking in certain parts of the world and in certain religious systems. So what we have now is an interesting array of possibilities in terms of how one can approach mindfulness. I first came across it in 1964. I think it was 1964. I was in India and I read a book by a person called Rear Admiral Shattuck, who had done a mindfulness, he called it a mindfulness retreat in Burma. And he described this, he described all the experiences he went through. And I thought, you know, this is great, it sounds so wonderful. You go and you sit there and all these monks are around and you only eat once a day. That didn't appeal to me very much, but it seemed to be part of the deal. And then all these things happen in your mind. So I wrote to these Burmese people, I said, can I come and do one of these courses? And about 6 months later, they wrote back and said no. So fortunately, I didn't start in Burma. But I read what I could of people's experience of mindfulness in those days. And it sounded as though you do the training, you do the practice, and then it kind of unfolds according to a predetermined plan. And this was very much the idea I had, because, you know, as Chairman said, I'm a dyed-in-the-wool lawyer. I spent years and years studying to be a lawyer, and I was never any good. But I developed this idea that things always work progressively according to a predetermined plan. Heather's nodding because she knows this. She's also a lawyer. So I started doing this mindfulness, and I thought, well, I will have the same experiences as Admiral Shattuck and a few other people I read about. And that, I think, is when things started coming apart. Because I made this rather disturbing discovery that mindfulness progresses according to the state of your own mind. And what other people have experienced is not necessarily any indication of what's going to happen to you. So this was quite a shock for me, because what happened to Admiral Shattuck was nothing like what happened to me. And the result is, I came out of my first retreat with a Burmese monk, which was a three-week retreat, convinced that I was the archetypal failure, that I had not done it correctly, or that the system didn't work for me, or something like that. So I think what that taught me is, each one of us, when we come to mindfulness, will approach it and learn it in our own unique way. And this, I think, is helpful if we remember it, because to me this is very much what the whole path is about. Finding out your own potential, and then finding out how you can develop it within certain parameters. Now, the parameters that are offered us from the East are very different from the ones that work for most Westerners. Because within the Eastern systems, mindfulness was taught within very strict and in fact rigid contexts, where you definitely did certain things for certain numbers of hours and you went through a progression. And I know a lot of Westerners have tried that, and it doesn't work very well for them. Now, this is no criticism of the Eastern systems, but it raised questions in my mind. So when I then began meeting lamas, I became the absolute pest, because I wanted to know what happened in their minds when they practiced mindfulness. And of course, then I came upon this discovery that this is something you don't talk about. In the East, you do not discuss your experience. You do not talk about what happens to you. And I was quite puzzled about this in the beginning, until I read a few books and they said, well, the reason you don't talk about it is it can lead to boasting. So you sit in your cell and you practice your mindfulness and nobody knows what's going on. I suspect most of them slept most of the time. Because I've watched when you're in a group with a lot of particularly various types of Easterners. They look very peaceful. And they are extremely peaceful. But they give themselves away now and again and they all snore. So I'm not quite sure how it works there. But of course, if we're lucky, we also do fall asleep. I know, to me, a successful mindfulness session of, say, 1 hour is when I've managed to sleep through at least half an hour. But unfortunately, it's not always as good as that for me. But I've watched a lot of the students, and they sit there and they think they're meditating or being mindful, and their eyes droop and their heads lower down. And then afterwards we have interviews, and I say, well, how was your session? I had a very good session. So I've begun to realize that there's a great deal of comparison between the amount of sleep we can get and the success of our session. But that's fine. You know, it's new to us and it's very different because we Westerners are used to being stimulated a lot. Our whole educational system is based on constant stimulation, and then when it comes to something like mindfulness, that is not there.